children of immigrants doing parkour in public space in Turin, I could not just ask them what is their experience. I try to ask them. they just look at me and say, I cannot tell you. There are no words to express this. So this meant that also, especially regarding to embodied practices, one of the most of the first tools that came to my mind was the visual, in order to grasp what the meaning, also the context they were acting in, also as it was said before, also the context they were responding to, using their practices, using their bodies, and also using their aesthetic. And also it allowed me to understand, to probe by showing that, by discussing with them photos and videos, their own views rather than my assumption of what capoeira and parkour meant to them. So discussing photos and videos with them allowed me to really understand, placed in the foreground, their experiences, their knowledges, and not my idea of what were they experiencing, and so on. And as I said before, I reduced my reliance on words. Actually, if I just use words, I have almost no data. So, most of the times, relying on a video, on a photo, like in the title, it was possible to recall a state of mind, an attitude, I would say also a philosophy of life in a way that could be catched just in a picture. So that's why video and photos helped me a lot. And also drawings are another way to articulate feelings that are hard to define. If sometimes there are some resistances, sometimes the older young adults, sometimes young adults, they just said, I don't know how to draw. So, but even if I didn't want to draw, just the blank paper in a way just showed something that could be used as a material to interpret it, to interpret. And that was really interesting when, as I say, the therapeutic setting is very different from the research setting. So when I asked individuals to make drawings, of course we didn't discuss it one by one, but asking permission, I used some drawings to make some group discussion about the specific scene, and it was really insightful to understand the different meanings of the same scene, to open up discussions, and sometimes very lively discussion about issues that were represented or linked to the scene. So drawings were also very very insightful in different way from photos. Photos were most individual in interviews, and drawings were more useful in group settings. But of course, I don't think that these are the strong points I found in my research, but I think visual methodologies have also some strong limitation, and in order to provide strong qualitative data, I think it's better to discuss those limitations and to understand them in order to offer significant data, since we don't use quantitative methods. The significance of our data is about how reflexive we are about our methodology. So these are the limitations that I found about my use of visual methodologies. First is that, as I think it was also anticipated before, child-led research methods are anyway accomplished in research contexts that are driven by adult agendas. In my experience, for example, when I work with unaccompanied minors, always in Turin, the funding came because there was a wave of moral panic about unaccompanied minors in Turin involved in drug dealing. So that's why we looked at their experience. Then we developed our participatory methods, but we just look at an agenda that is not coming from. So, and there could be many other interesting things to look that are not just look because they are not in the agendas of donors, and this is a limitation also because in the same case this was around 2006-2007 when there was the emergency about unaccompanied minors. There was plenty of funding for a couple of years. Then the situation was not solved as they were meaning, but just changed in a less visible way, and then fundings were just going somewhere else. And still, there's a need to understand more how this phenomenon is developing. So I think this is a really strong limitation that affect any kind of research, but also when we claim to do participatory research, I think we should acknowledge also our own limitation being researchers. And then also other two keywords that are used in visual and participatory research that are participation and empowerment. I think that there are very few unpacked and operationalized. Especially participation sometimes is something that is given quite for granted as something that is undifferentiated. All the children in a classroom or in an informal educational setting participate in the same way. And today there was a very nice example on how it's not happening about the video of the classroom. And it was, and the question was addressing this, was addressing, yes, but what about the silent children? What about, we heard about we could see the agency of the talking children, but what about the silent children? Are they participating, are they not? So I think that when we call for a participatory research and we talk about participation, then we really have to unpack what we intend. And also another thing that came to my mind now, also because participation when it's in child-led research, we should acknowledge also the relations between children and youth as researchers. The power relation in the group of children, some children can be marginalized, why, and there are if some of you happen to make some video interviews led by children, some it's really easy to see when some children just stop the answer of the other, and there are some dynamics going in there that are worth being explored, I think. The same with the other keyword of participatory research, that is empowerment, which is a word that sometimes can be abused a little bit because often it implies that it just come the researcher, the undertaking a participatory research, just come and give the power to the children, which are is empowered, and for that moment they learn too. And in my experience, I didn't see that. saw already, I just observed, and young people trying to empower themselves with the resources they had, and I just documented that. So I would look in a critical way some researches addressing empowering participatory research. Of course, a solid research can empower more participants, but it's not something that is just come from one direction, I think. And it's not something that it can given to and taken from participants just from adults. And the last thing that was quite funny when I clashed into it is that when I started to use photo voice with the respondents, a lot of photos were of them just showing off, just posing with friends, just showing their muscles, and in a way, these are also interesting materials to look at in a way. But in the other way, they didn't address exactly what I wanted to look. They just showed a certain ideal of personhood that they were trying to depict. And I remember one that he admitted that they just tried to act as he would like to be, but it was not actually his daily life. So it was interesting in a way, but we should be very careful in analyzing this data as they come. So these are, in my opinion, some of the limitations of the methods that that I used. And to end, to come to a conclusion, and hopefully to start a little bit of discussion. As I said before, I think as we are using a kind of qualitative data, it's important that these data are justified by a solid methodological rationale. So I found this simple question very useful to me when I started to use visual method, also because in my experience there are some images that are very extraordinary in a way. So to avoid that the temptation, which is kind of ambivalent ethically, to use images that are not really pertinent the research, I constantly try to reflect if I really needed this data, if this data really allowed me to arrive to a kind of insight that that I could not have in another way. So so this is the question: that what data does this visual method help me to obtain that I could not otherwise access? And yeah, and then two other issues that are very important, I think, quite obviously, but I stress them anyway, is the issue of ethics, since we are going to use images as we had this concern. Today we should have sometimes even more concern using images of that we take on research, even when sometimes the images are really something very important to us. Maybe we just can get the insights, but don't use them. I couldn't use today some of the images the participant gave me, because they were involving activities. They were in the gray area between the licit and the illicit, and I even if they gave in a way clearance. They trust me in a way to the use that they do with these pictures. I thought it's better to don't use some of these images. And also, we are talking about children and youth, sometimes young adults, so borders, even when children are not of the legal age. I found it important to discuss the clearance to use the images not only with parents or tutors, but also with the children themselves, and to try to explain very clearly the use that I was going to do with these images. And there are some cases, like if we are involved with street children, or my case with unaccompanied minors, that there are no parents or tutors, at least not close to us. So in these occasions is really even more important to discuss with them, to make clear that a very clear negotiation about what we are going to do with the images. And this brings also to the issue of the ownership, that in a way can be totally of course of the researcher, neither totally of the participant, but it has to be always negotiated. And I find it's fair that every participant had images of the same images they produced. I stayed with the copy, and they stayed with the copy too. And yes, in terms of analysis, we use images in order to reach participants' experiences and views, and not to just to make assumption on that. So about the analysis, I think it's the more appropriate persons to give meaning to the images are the respondents. So all the insights that I received were coming from respondents commenting the images, not me looking at the images and discussing with them and guessing what they were thinking about. I think this is very important, because if we really want to make heard children's voice, we have to use children's voice. We have to listen to children's voice, and not in a way, in a moment, jump in and use the material to confirm our hypothesis and so on. And this means also to relinquish a little bit from our position in the research. I think that our position come later, our role as a researcher come later, when we find a pattern in a way from what the participants say, and then we link these patterns to the theoretical framework. So this means a little bit to make a step behind and to really let the children talk about what they're asking in the research. And the last reflection I want to share with you is about is linked to what I'm going to show you briefly right now. Maybe we have more time than what I thought, so I can show you both clips entirely, or almost entirely. There are two short clips, and it's about the analysis of the material we made, especially regarding also regarding photos, but especially regarding videos, because also the process of making images is important, not only the image. Where the photo or the video were made, what was the context, what was the situation, to what situation it was related or responding, and who is the intended audience of the images produced. Because if we think that they made just for us, the participants may think what we want to know, or the participants may want to show us something that they think that it's gonna please us in a way. So it can be really different from a video they just made for themselves, just to for any reason it could be. But the most important, if we acknowledge this process, then we can also give a direction to the analysis, give a direction to when we discuss, when we comment the images with the participants. So we can really get different viewpoints and insights about that. So asking also about, oh, what are you doing now? Or why you think just this particular moments, big moment, and not another one? And then I'm going to show you now, I got another useful insight about the moment in which this group of kids, very heterogeneous, Romania, from Dominican Republic, Brazil, Morocco, they were all together, and they just asked, there was a street, how can I can explain? There was a small street activity from a street bibliothèque, street library, and I just asked to the educators running the activity to make a presentation of capoeira, just at the moment. It's quite funny, and then they edited the video and they put it on YouTube. And then they told me, ah, you're looking at this, look at what we've done. And when I asked that why they wanted to participate to this street activity, they just said, yeah, we wanted to show people what we are capable to do. And people usually, and one of them said, it was plenty of the old ladies that when we passed by, they just hold their bags. So we wanted to show them how we. So I don't know if they got the the response that they hoped for, but anyway, you will see the video. And that video that I told you about is very different, in some way different, and in some way very similar to another video that some unaccompanied minors did about a drama workshop. In which there were two groups of unaccompanied minors for the street education project. For what I worked, there were two groups of unaccompanied minors. One was making a drama workshop, and one did the videotaping of the workshop and of the shows they made. And then they edited the video, and they made a really nice video. But then they made it to promote the workshop, to promote the project. They had different means to record. So you will see the differences maybe, and then maybe we can also, if we have something to tell about this, we can discuss also about this. So if it's okay for you, I show you both videos. The first one is the one from the social project. It was founded by a big foundation, and so the means are very high quality, but the kids, let's say the participants, really did almost all by themselves after a short training, and they learned very quickly. And so you almost all that you see is the participant videotaping and editing the video. And then I will show you the video made by the participant themselves that they gave to me.
Ting. Is the light switch outside, or? I think it's outside, but can you look?
Thank you.
Choose the music, they edited the material and everything. Every time I find it very nice, but I also find it a little bit polished in a way. All the narrative is about this empowerment process, starting from the project that you've seen in the first scenes. So starting making the mask, and then again the scenes, the first improvisation that they film, it all talks about a discourse of empowerment that is kind of influenced because the participant knew that this video would go to the donors. So I think this is a way also to analyze our material, because they did by themselves, is totally participatory, but in a way it is quite different from what I'm going to show now. And I advise you, the soundtrack they choose this time is a little more noisy. So I beware you of this. They did it with their mobiles. And this is the street actually.
Thank you.
were able to discuss with me these images were very insightful for me. First, the music they chose was the first thing that I asked them, why this one? And there are different themes related to the music. One, for the understanding they have of English, this song say two sentences they liked a lot. At the beginning, let the body feel the flow. So capoeira is made with music, and they really like this idea, or let the body express and go and do other things. And the second one is nothing wrong with me, repeated and repeated again. And it's something that they quite articulate later, that they try to show to the adults present. I don't know if you paid attention that most of the audience were adults, not so young adults, they were quite. And so I think they were able to express through these choices, not so conscious in a way, but really visible, what they make of their practices, or at least they made it clear to me. And so by talking about the music, it was so easier for them to arrive to talk about the way they wanted to show to the people there that they were not just thugs or immigrants, workers, as their fathers and as their parents, but they are something else, they are able to do something. And and in a way, I can tell, because it was a neighbor when I mostly made the research, it was actually seen with sympathy, this attempt of, so they quite made a successful attempt. And although also we can analyze as researcher an idea also by the choice of the music and by the choice of the practice they used, an idea of masculinity. They were all male, they were doing a practice that involves the fight, they were and the music is quite muscular in a way, so we can talk also about this. But it was very insightful to hear them, to listen to them while we were saying, we were articulating all these things, starting from a video they made. So in a way I see quite some differences from the video I showed you before. So that's it, and I'm still thinking about all these things, and I'm quite stuck, so I'm sorry I can't articulate more about this. And I hope if you have any comments, any things to say, I hope we can start to do a small discussion together.
There's a book, film as ethnography. Has anybody looked at it? No. And I can't remember her name. I think her name's Halpern or something. She's a female anthropologist doing research in Iceland, I believe. And she was trying to understand, document this male, exclusively male ritual, this ram festival, okay, mm-hmm. where all these men come together and compare rams. And women of the village where she was, like, they had no interest in going to this event, you know, it was just not, but, and they weren't allowed in the event, but it was, you know, working both ways. And then I forget where she was from, but they agreed to let her go. And she was interested in using visual methods. And she was taking pictures, I believe. And I won't go into the graphic details of the Ram Festival, but she was saying that the pictures could not reveal, well, for her, the thickness of her as a female researcher being in this all-male context of men comparing rams. So like her effect on the research, what she felt in the experience, how she interpreted people looking at her, how she affected, or how her presence affected it, just the image was not adequate. It just didn't carry that type of data. She was trying to figure out why. And I don't know if she came up with a good answer, but so for her, the text was essential to contributing to a reflexive process. I just thought of that as I was looking at you in terms of interpreting these, using visual means and being reflexive about the visual means, and the first one perhaps not revealing that kind of reflexivity without your interpretation. Mm-hmm. Do you know what I mean? So how are you negotiating use of text and use of image in presenting your findings in a way of being reflexive about the process itself? And did you find one, did you have any success with using the visual in helping understand that reflexivity? Does that make sense? Am I asking the question right?
Yeah, but I also, if I will try to answer to the question, but also if we phrase also our intervention or comments also to everyone.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's not just me.
Yeah, yeah.
That it's not, I was trying to make something more interactive. So I don't know if I am successful, but
all
if we all interact, I think it's not just me giving answers, because I'm not an expert at all.
Yeah.
But if we have something, if any one of us has something to say, for what I understood, you mean how can we be reflexive also in understanding our assumptions, our subtext in interpreting the visual material that we have.
Yeah, and does the visual method itself present some limitations in trying to do that?
Yes. I think, first of all, being trying to figure out the limitation in a way and strengthen the insights that we received from them.
Yeah.
So first, focusing on what we cannot know, what we cannot derive from them, then gets out the limitation.
Yeah.
The first thing, I think, is that. And the second thing, as I said before, images can be taken from the researcher, can be taken from the participant, can be taken from the participant with a name or with another name, the process of... So we have to take in account all of these factors, I think, and every factor influences the data that we receive and how we interpret the data.
Yeah.
So in a way, that's why I think it's important that if participants produce images, they command the images.
Yeah.
So our subtext, in a way, we just use some material that is really concerning our research.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if, I think this, in this way, I intend to reflexivity in the way, first acknowledging limitations.
Mm-hmm.
The limitation of being a female researcher in a male context of male comparing ranks is quite, I don't know it's complicated, so. So even if we just draw the limit of our reflections, then we can still see something. At least I realize that I cannot do research by being a female in a male context.
Yeah.
In this male context, this is also a.
Yeah.
I don't know if anyone has something else to add about his comment.
When I started building on that, one of the things that struck me about this research, and I think it pertains to your example as well, is just how a strength of visual research is being able to get an embodied agency rather than just reflective agency.
Mm-hmm.
So like in that video, you really see how their agency is at a level of embodiment that they might not even, like maybe they realize it when they talk about it with you afterwards, but being able to do something powerful with their bodies is representative for them, like presents to people an image that's different for them. And the researcher going in, like she's coming in as a woman to a male context,
yeah.
She's embodied, she can't change that, and
yeah.
It doesn't like, so the visual image, I mean, it would have been interesting to have a picture of her in a situation that she can't do, because then you would get a picture of not only, like agency happens at both of those levels, and then after we take it away and we talk about it at a reflective level, but probably first we encounter it at an embodied level. So that video is so powerful because they're, like it's without the reflective level at first, it's just them on their cell phones. And very embodied level. So maybe that's, I don't know if that's a strength, because I think we sort of freeze people, like children or people that can't, don't have reflective agency, don't have that ability. If we only do research that are reflective, like we ask them to come in and say, what does capoeira mean to you? And they're like, I don't have words for that. I don't know. But to start from embodiment enables us to. And then in that very process, it enhances their agency by being able to talk at a reflective level, of which a lot of like powerful power is located kind of at that level in society.
Yeah. And if I can add to what you said, the reason why I focus on body and embodiment
mm-hmm.
is probably because it's the first of our instruments. So when we look at marginalized groups, sometimes even unconsciously, is the first tool that they use to express their capacity to have power on their context. So sometimes is displayed in a way that reproduces also the structure.
Mm-hmm.
If we think about the cult of macho or machism or muscles, there are a way to use the body to accept power, but in a way that confers power in a way.
Mm-hmm.
But so I don't also about analyzing their use of the body, especially regarding capoeira. I think I have also to be careful in stressing to don't put too much of enthusiasm
mm-hmm.
in the agency side, because there is also a reproduction
mm-hmm.
of an idea of masculinity in a way,
mm-hmm.
but still, I think there is something that is probably also less conscious, is more active, that, like you say, is less reflexive, but still saying we use what we can use at the moment to claim our place in the society where we live, and. Saying that we are capoeirista, we don't say that we are Moroccan, that we are Romanian, living in Italy, that is another way to negotiate an identity. So this is, I think, the agency part, but of
mm-hmm.
course in the same process there is also the part that in which the body reproduces a certain kind of structure. And gender relation, then we could go on.
Were you there when they did that?
No,
that
I was not there.
The last one.
I just played.
Okay.
I was not there.
Because I mean, with that music, it kind of accentuates a sort of anger
yeah.
and frustration
yeah.
and a kind of violent sort
yeah.
of cry.
Definitely.
And I don't know if it was a sort of a nice sort of party atmosphere in the street. You know,
yeah.
And people went, "Oh, this is great!" And then they were all sort of jolly, or if
yeah.
it was, and then what you're looking at then is we are influenced by our interpretation is influenced not by the visual,
yeah.
solely. We've got this
yeah,
extra layer
mm-hmm.
Of the oral message that they've
yeah.
chosen to put with it,
yeah.
and that to me that could have. Changed entirely from the event that happened in the streets. What people took away from
mm.
it, So, you know, were the people standing around, if they had that kind of music in the background, they might not have wanted to stay and go, well, what they're doing, and run away.
Absolutely.
Angry men.
That's why, that's really really good point, because absolutely the atmosphere of the party was totally easygoing, and they put the, of course, the capoeira song, capoeira music, which was totally another atmosphere. But and
they had capoeira music playing when they were doing
that. There was this street library with a small sound system, so they just put the CD in and just started doing, and people were enjoying it. This also, the music is light-hearted, and they were doing a lot of things, a lot of so people were enjoying, and I absolutely agree with you. This sense of I will not say of payback in a way, I don't know, of frustration, of anger, came in the editing.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So that's why that's why I thought it was more important to use their editing,
mm-hmm,
rather than the original footage,
mm-hmm,
because both can tell us something, but if we really want to analyze the process and that brought to this product, the music, tells us something very, very strong.
As a researcher, though, you know, you've got those two. Well, let's simplify and say soundtracks.
Yeah.
Okay, influencing our interpretation.
Yeah.
So how do you make a story out of that? What points do you draw as a researcher when you've got two stories that don't match each other, don't complement each other? Do you go, oh, that one actually, you know, I'm kind of drawn towards that because that sort of ticked lots of boxes in my head as a researcher? And, you know, do you tell the story of the party atmosphere and the first version without the angry music? It seems to me that there's a sort of a pleasing element, a sort of showmanship, a theatre, a wish to please that performers have. They want acceptance from their audience in some way that doesn't come across in that video with that music.
Yeah, but for sure, I would say two things. For sure, I didn't have any doubt on what material to analyze, because they brought me the video with the music, not with the original, the video they edited. So I, based on that, and then out of curiosity, I said, yeah, but can you show me the original video? Just,
mm-hmm.
And secondly, and this could be also our interpretation as adults, as it's not being part of the youth culture in this moment, is that the music is angry,
mm-hmm,
and expressing frustration and so on. That was not what they said. They were saying, yeah, I like this music, it really gives me energy too, and then I like the, so, of course.
It's not the Four Seasons though, is it?
It's not, no, at all. But also, I would say that also in the 60s, the first amplified music was seen as very extreme.
Mm-hmm.
So, as we take in account also what is not said, we take in account also our perception. But as I said before, I wanted to. I think as a researcher we can notice the part of frustration that we feel about that the music express, but. What they say is at least the equal importance to be reported. So what they say that is a music that I like, that gives me energy and I found it very well. I thought less on frustration and more on that videos where like skateboarding videos where fast-paced music and acrobacies.
Mm-hmm.
of course, in a rougher way, in a more muscular way, but I didn't want also to think only in the way of angry music, mm-hmm. expressing only frustration and disease from and unease from the youth, because there is also another kind of I don't want to use the word stereotype, but is another leitmotif in interpreting your culture,
yeah.
in a way. So I was just careful in using my perception of the music. This is how I directed myself in interpreting the material.
I think it's a question that is, when we're researching, especially when it's about agency, there seems to be a bit of a conflict between our position as researchers and their position as accessing people and establishing a position of trust, where you take what you've got from them, and then you've got an extra part of your job, which is the drawing together and interpreting and bringing it together to make some kind of sense or a story. I don't know if anyone else has got anything to say about that additional layer that we as researchers can't just present a list of quotes or video clips. Our job is to interpret in some way.
And, I mean, much of what we talked about in terms of interpreting these two videos is the editing process, the choices that they made in the production of the video, as opposed to the video itself standing alone as the representation. Do you know what I mean? So, in a sense, that question you're asking of which one do we choose, well, when we take into account both, we're accounting for greater complexity, although they weren't accounting for both. They were making a choice for, well, in a different in one situation, they were making one choice, in another situation, they were making another choice. It becomes tricky, I think, in terms of how you navigate that.
Yeah, but as you said, we were just discussing about the process that we didn't even get to the embodied practices. And
right.
So we started to think. So I think is the strength of this kind of methodologies and of qualitative research, that it can be really, really complexified. We
yeah.
can be a multi-layer analysis of what we see. And of course, we use the quotes, we use the images, and we, as I said before, I think our role is to create patterns, to link this material to our theoretical framework, to our questions, and probably not to answer, but just to pose more deepen questions about what we are looking, because of course I totally agree with you. There's a note of frustration, for example, in the music. But what if this can be one point? So it can be part of a complex analysis of what we are saying. And then it comes the body part. Then it comes analysis of the interaction with the public, the use of public space, the transformation of a backyard in a stage. There are a lot of layers that, if we want, we can look at. That's what makes our lives difficult.
Which is probably which is the nature of research, really.
Yeah.
And so it's interesting that we have such a clear example in your, with the two choices of two or two videos and which one you choose. But any type, just living in our life, there's no action that's without interpretation.
Mm-hmm.
It depends on the context always, and probably the meaning comes from the meaning comes from the interaction between the people, all the people in the video, and then also between them and you and the objective video that we should access somehow by having a proper lens. We're just always in that process.
Yes, and yeah, thank you. The meanings that we give, in a way, is co-constructed with them.
Mm-hmm.
And I think this is the most important. It's not just us assuming what we think they were thinking. So even if it's not definitive, it's co-constructed, it's an interaction, it's relational. In a way, I think this is the strongest point of an approach involving of what the research that we are trying to do, in a way, a more participatory research. And using visual methods can be just another leg in the table to support our ideas, our hypotheses, and so it's really about co-constructing the meanings that we find, the knowledge that we find about them.
I was wondering about that, just to follow up on that, because I wonder whether you have videos of them doing either capoeira or parkour in different contexts, because
yeah.
I'm wondering what influence that would have both on their physical movements. I mean, I know capoeira is mainly social, but parkour, I think they can practice on their own as well. So is that different? And there's also a relationship between group and self, I suppose, and in terms of what the body movement means to them as a person. As opposed to in a group, as opposed to a group with an audience. I mean, there's so many different layers to that in terms of identity as well. I think that would
yeah.
be quite interesting to actually explore how the different contexts are different, and then the analysis is actually in comparing context rather than necessarily just comparing what they say about it, but looking at how they do these, how they enact agency in different contexts, maybe. I was wondering whether you had... Do you have them on an individual basis as well, or only in groups?
I don't have visual material
mm.
on individual basis, but most of them they counted to me that, for example, they go to train on themselves but they say also that they feel better when they feel better when they meet in group,
mm-hmm.
and there could be another another direction of analysis to
mm.
look on how the practice is used on the individual level as a way of to build a personal path of identity, or as a way of well-being, or just get fit, just to work
mm-hmm.
out. Né? And how is used in a way to socialize
mm-hmm.
with the group of peers, with broader context, and going on and on, always in a macro direction.
Yeah.
And what was nice that some photo they gave me about parkour, and I didn't put in. They were training group and they were using a public park. And like with seats and with some other furnitures as an open air gym, so it is 10-12 guys doing push-ups and abdominals before starting to do the parkour. So it was already a message to the community, and even if we didn't mean that, it was already that, but they already exert the power to transform the use of the public park.
They put up a membership desk and
yeah.
stuff.
Yes,
so hard right. to get in.
Yeah, yeah. They say that we cannot afford the gym. No?
Yeah.
We make it here.
Yeah.
no worries about that. So I had the idea to do a short work group exercise that I think we don't have the time to do. That would be to plan together, to find together an informal settings where it could be meaningful to develop a research with children or youth, and also to see what could be the limitations of the mm-hmm. methods that we could use in the setting, but I don't think we have time for that.
Is it over now?
Yeah, it's 5 minutes.
5 minutes.
5 minutes to go, so.
Can I ask a question about something you said earlier? Yeah?
Yeah.
You were talking about, I think it was, you were comparing drawings versus photos in terms of eliciting group discussion.
Yeah.
And you said one was more effective than the other for you.
Could
you expand on that? I can't remember what
Yeah, no, probably I was not clear about it. I just didn't use the photos. And I don't think they are.
No, but in your instance, you used drawings and you found it really useful in group discussion?
Yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah.
So how did you? What did you do, and how did it work?
There were two kind of interaction. One was in directly informal setting already, so out in the streets.
Yeah.
And it happened, and they maybe were with the school bags, and they were. They have paper, and
yeah.
One started to. So it was very. It was not planned.
Yeah.
Started to design because there was one participant who loved to make graffiti. So he was just making a model.
Yeah.
And I just jumped in and asked, why don't you paint about the situation that just happened the other day? And it happened a situation like of violence with. Violence of tension with police.
Yeah.
So why don't you paint that scene and then we discussed it all together. So in that situation, then they came some experiences they had with the issue of authority, that it could be not also police forces but also adults.
Yeah.
That say that sometimes they related with them. In certain ways, or chase them in some situation because their adults can be also drunk adults or homeless. That sometimes they had problems with them. So it was just an option. And then the other was focus group. And a part of the focus group, I asked two participants to draw a specific scene, and we discussed the scenes together.
And did you feel like the drawing, when you thought it was effective at evoking discussion, were people referencing the drawing, or how did the drawing?
Sorry.
How did the drawing? What role did the drawing play in that discussion?
Was in a way, I don't know if the right word is was kind of a trigger.
Yeah.
It was like from that situation, and I guess. To explain what he drew,
yeah.
And the other say, yeah, this reminds me of this, or I was there, and I, even people were there, they talk about the way that they lived the thing, so
yeah.
many different views, point of view. And that brought to different assumptions, experiences of assumptions about relation, the case with authority, or and in that case it was very interesting because the passage was police, teachers, fathers.
Yeah.
So it was in a way that as psychologists it was also quite insightful. Quite clear that, and they were put all in the same way, and there were these underlying idea of the parents being very disempowered,
yeah.
And trying to exert more control on them,
yeah.
And the same in some way. The police just by wanted to chase them by default because they really didn't know anything about them, and they just wanted to saw them as thugs. So, but then there's again there would be another way of interpret the data, as in cross-cultural psychology there are a lot of issues about the generational inversion of children of immigrants toward their parents.
Right.
So again, there will be more complexities to add to the picture.
Mm-hmm.
But in to come again to your question, it was really quite. I don't know how to say. It's more difficult to build the situation than to moderate the discussion.
Yeah.
And then it's really like just listening.
Yeah. And part of the reason I'm asking is photo elicitation sometimes gets criticized in group work because if the person didn't take the image, or if an image is taken of someone in a particular situation, they might say, "Well, I don't remember. Or I don't know what about." Or in a group discussion, they might say, "I don't know. You know, that's not me, or I wasn't there, or whatever." There's something about an image where it's sort of difficult. It may be so literal in its representation that you can't project your own sort of personal experience on it. Even and then, you take, for example, a graffiti image that will be maybe more or less literal. And so it allows people to look at it and say, oh, I can bring my experience to that image and talk about it.
I'm thinking of, that's made me think of a paper by someone called Galasinska in 2010, where she was working with people who lived in an area and showing them pictures of the area when it was developed. I think it was in a city in Poland. It was developed and McDonald's had come in and built a mall, and it was on the site of something that had been a cinema, and before that it had been a common land, a sort of open field, and there were three photographs, and what she found was that people were talking about things that weren't in the photo. People who remembered what was there before or things that had happened around it, and so It was a trigger, it was a prompt for opening up discussion of their memories, so to access very less tacit aspects of their knowledge of the area. And what it had been about was asking them, I think, what the how they felt about this new development, and it actually opened up this whole new historical aspect, and led them into talking about the politics and the way the town was run and how bribery had been used. Wow, you know, from these three sets of photos, a lot came out. You know, that wasn't necessarily expected or planned, as you say. Mm. Very interesting.
What's your relationship with? What's your relationship with the participants? You know, like, did you just come upon them in the street? Or are you working in an agency that where they come
right.
to?
Right. I totally forgot about that. Small detail. also the reason why I focused on Corporate Parkour was a reason of accessibility to the field. So I practiced capoeira with some of them. With just a couple of them, which now are already quite grown up, but they were the one who inspired me to look at this. And when I work as street educators, usually what we do as part of our activities when we were outside, it was just playing, not even making capoeira, but playing with them to just teach them some acrobats and some things. But it was just meant to build a relation. It was meant to make a capoeira classes or what. What was really surprising that they took this. They went. Some of them went on YouTube. They went wherever they went and looked for more, and started training by themselves. So it was again they used. Input, something that they were in their lives, the street educators wandering around, trying to get in touch with them, and they used that and say, yeah, well, why not? And they used it in, they find a way to. So when I came there, it was easier for me to get in touch with them to being a practitioner too.
So actually, they trusted you.
Yeah. In a way, it was easier. Who didn't know me, it was easier to be trust, because actually they knew that I was making a research, but I was not standing there looking them while I was injuring with them. So it was easier also to get in touch and to build trust, to build relationship. So I would say the main way, although some of them knew me already in a way, so that helped also by practicing with them was the turning point, was the point. Yeah. I think we've finished.
We've actually, I just looked at the schedule, it's still 1:45, but so I don't know how long your exercise is going to be, your little time. It's okay, it doesn't matter. I didn't want to disrupt the discussion either, so I just thought we'll keep going. But I don't know if, so we have 10 minutes, a bit more than 10 minutes, if you still want to do the task that you have in mind.
I don't know, I ask to you, if you're interested in brainstorming about what could be an interesting format, setting to like it, children and youth agency, and how we could just brainstorm.
I have more questions for you too. I know you don't want to answer my question.
No, I
it's a question that is something that I have found tricky in my own research in terms of ethics. You said that when you gave them cameras, they were taking some pictures that were kind of sort of not that grey area, grey,
yeah,
kind of stuff. What did you do with that? Like, you said you didn't look at these, but...
No, I look at these, but...
how did you deal with this?
But first, for example, my role as a researcher is not one of like the position of authority.
Mm-hmm.
So although I don't encourage anyone to do something which is in this gray area, what I can do of this material is to use it to understand what is being made, what they do, why they choose to show to me, and what they choose, and of course what they choose to do that at all, so why they choose to engage in that activity.
Mm.
And that is the thing that I agree with you, is a tricky situation, because it's very...
I mean, how far do you go with granting confidentiality when someone is disclosing something that...
Yeah,
unacceptable in some other situations or settings.
I could say that in a way I didn't posit myself as an adult judging them.
Yeah.
So I was just trying to understand why are you showing to me, and to get out from fantasies. It was really few things. It was about entering in abandoned buildings.
Mm-hmm.
It was not really serious stuff. Of course, it would be serious stuff. They would be even more tricky, and I don't know. I definitely would go to speak with someone, with a supervisor, on how to deal with this. But I chose, when I designed the project, I acknowledge that something not really illicit I could meet. So I decided that my position would be to don't judge it, but to use it as a material, as long as it was not harming anyone. So I was, and how can I say, although violence exists in the context where I was making research, it was not something that they wanted to show directly with their images, and they were, most of the time, they were not the ones acting, rather they were the one suffering from attempt from threat and from harms and that thing. So the illicit things would be like shooting a friend, making a photo of a friend, making a graffiti, which is illegal in my in my country, but still I was quite confident that and or just climbing the wall would bring to an abandoned factory. So these were the, I was even more concerned about that they would meet more situation like this, but they're quite good guys. So I don't know if you, I don't know.
Oh no, I was just thinking, because I've had like instances when children have told me something that I cannot possibly keep to myself, and I would have to report it back to someone.
Yeah.
And I thought that your situation might have been with the same magnitude, but obviously not.
Yeah, of course we are engaged, we are involved in the lives of our respondents. So of course is there, I think if it's there a case of danger of personal death, then when the research comes last in a way. But
are you working with young children?
Previously I've worked with secondary school children, now I work with quite young children.
Okay.
But like with, because I know with like youngsters, I mean young adults, it's more tricky, because like as soon as they start seeing you more as a friend or more like one of them, because they know that you're not a teacher, you're not judging, they start telling you stuff that at one point you're like, don't tell me, I don't want to know that, because it's like, because I have to do something.
But then
about
of course then you say, if I ask them and if I tell them this, then I don't know, they will not come to me in a way.
Yeah, exactly.
Just
a balance of how much you're their friend and how much you're not their friend, so that you retain that distance in a way.
In a case, if it can be a meaningful example, for example, if somebody comes to me saying that he's a 16 years boy, comes to me saying, oh, my girlfriend is pregnant, but we don't know what to do. I definitely think that I'm not the one that is going to solve this, but I can be definitely the one that can explain them where to go, where to go. So I'm not a counselor, but I can tell them where is the counselor, and I can even go with them to the counselor. And I think I'm still in the position of a researcher. Of course, I will, if I carry their situation on me, then is where the limit is passed. If they say to them, oh, that's your problem, I'm just a researcher, it's finished with the relation. So I think we can, in a way, we are not morally neutral, so in a way we can facilitate some situations, but we cannot solve them.
In one of my recent interviews with a trainee teacher, she arrived at the interview and I was borrowing somebody's office for the day, and she told me that she was pregnant, and that was lovely, and so we carried on with her second child and the interview carried on, and as she was going on, she was sort of becoming more and more deflated and lacking energy and losing focus, her words were becoming blurred, she was getting sweaty. And I said, oh, shall I go and get you a cup of tea and some biscuits and need a bit of an energy boost? And I came back, she had almost passed out. And just as she was losing consciousness, she said, diabetic.
Oh my gosh.
And at that point, I stopped being a researcher.
Yeah.
Oh my god.
Like, okay, this interview, like, that's...
Oh my gosh.
So it's kind of like you said, but the research isn't always the most important thing.
Mm.
So I called an ambulance for her and they...
Oh my gosh.
Popped her full of insulin and she...
Oh.
And popped back up again.
I know.
But I was there because I was thinking, you know, I was a bit slow to react because I was thinking, you know, maybe after she's had a cup of tea, we can carry on with the interview.
Now we have to start interviews by saying, do you have any allergies? Any pre-existing conditions I should know about?
I had never thought about asking those questions.
So you asked the question, what will visual methods allow me to know that other methods won't, or something like that? That question that you asked in there?
Yeah.
What data does this visual method help me to obtain that I cannot otherwise access? So how did you answer that question? I mean, through the work that you did.
Yeah, it was really that looking at the embodied practices first to explain the embodied practices, it would be really, really much more difficult. And so I needed some more support in making my arguments. And then also when I found myself struggling with the possibility to understand the embodied experience of the participants, I found myself in need of a data that could help me with this, but I use this as a kind of reminder that sometimes if I, for example, now I know that there is I can manage a little bit more these methodologies, and then I can go on in the fields just applying them, and sometimes it can be a boomerang, I don't know. So I just try to think that if it worked in this context where I made, in the context when where I made research, because it was the context there was, and the questions that were calling for it, and it's not that it absolutely needed or
right.
necessary.
Or that it's better than another.
Or that it's better at all, totally. It's definitely, it's not that it's better, but it's probably a different source of data. So also these author Lomax, in the slide with Lomax, she argues that also to be careful in using these methods as something as the best way now to elicit data, because they just give us a different view on what we could do. So we just